When Charlie Dang was growing up in Philadelphia, he dreamed of playing professional basketball.
We just shoot hoops and dream of one day making it big in the NBA, so it's part of being American.
But America is just a memory for Dang. He plays his Sunday pickup game 9,000 miles from Philadelphia, in Phnom Penh, the capital of Cambodia, where his parents were born. Dang is not here by choice. He grew up in the U.S. as a legal permanent resident, a child of war refugees. But in 2011, he was deported to a country he never knew.
Everything was different. It was like a culture shock. The environment is different. The people are different. The language is different.
His crime was firing a gun in the air during a gang standoff when he was 15 years old. He served 5 years, and upon release, the government ordered him deported, but didn't act on it. He got a job and had 5 kids. But deportation orders never expire, and 8 years later, when Dang went for a routine immigration check-in, he was detained and put on a plane to Cambodia. He says there's a stigma to being a deportee.
We're in our own category because the Cambodian community look at us as foreigners who decided to come back. And those that know that we're deported, they look at us like, oh, we're criminals that got rejected from another country, so why are we back in Cambodia?
Dang is one of 550 deportees from America now living in Cambodia. They began arriving in 2002 when this country signed a repatriation agreement with the U.S. to accept green card holders of Cambodian descent who had committed aggravated felonies, even nonviolent offenses that carried short sentences. The Cool Lounge, a bar run by deportees, is home away from home for these people who went to American schools, listened to American music, ate American food. Chandara Tep is from Modesto, California.
I grew up 4th of July, you know, fireworks, barbecues, you know, spring breaks. I shed tears when 9/11 happened, you know, because I felt like I was American too.
Tep was deported 6 years ago following his conviction for assaulting a police officer. Sophia Fia and Bobby Orne also arrived in 2011. Calvin Heng in 2004. Heng and Fia weren't born in Cambodia. Like many deportees, they were born in refugee camps in Thailand after their parents fled war and the genocidal Khmer Rouge regime that ruled Cambodia in the 1970s and killed 2 million people. The American bombing of Cambodia during its war in Vietnam added to the chaos. The U.S. eventually granted asylum to 150,000 Cambodian refugees between 1975 and 1994.
You come from a jungle to a concrete jungle. You over here in Cambodia, you know, you're dodging bullets. Over there, you're living in the project, you're dodging muggers and robbers and thieves.
In the States, being in bad neighborhoods, sometimes we make mistakes, and sometimes we go on the wrong path and not knowing what the bigger consequences are.
These children of refugees say they had no idea their brushes with the law made them vulnerable to deportation. Calvin Heng says he didn't fight his assault with a deadly weapon charge and accepted a 1-year sentence, not knowing that made him deportable.
We weren't informed about taking a plea bargain or anything like that. If we take a plea bargain, we could be, you know, we could face deportation and so on and so on. We didn't know any of that until like now when we started doing our research.
American immigration judges have no leeway to consider how potential deportees have rehabilitated their lives. Tep had been out of prison for 13 years when he was deported, leaving a wife and 3 kids behind.
We changed our lives. We had families, you know, we bought a home. You know, we did all that stuff already, and then knock, knock, you know, you gotta go because you're not a citizen.
By the time they land in Cambodia, deportees have been stripped of all American identification. Cambodian immigration officials give them a single document with their name, birth date, and photo. Their lives start over from scratch.
I had no luggage. I had about $150 in my pocket. No possessions at all.
Everything is in Cambodian, and you don't even know how to write your name in Cambodian.
Local officials wouldn't even recognize Heng's immigration document, so he got creative.
My uncle had to play my dad, and then I had to be put into his family book and use the identity of my cousin that passed away the year before I came. So I was under a whole new identity for 12, 13 years.
What do you say to the comment that I'm sure you guys get a lot? Tough luck. You guys had an opportunity in the States. You blew it.
What I say? My answer is always like this, you know, yes, I messed up, I confess to it, you know what I mean? But you're not seeing where we're coming from, you know, we're refugees of the war. And I lost my rights, of course, because I'm not a citizen. But my kids has rights, my mom has rights, my right to be a family member, my right to be with one another, you know what I mean?
I do believe that you do the crime, you do the time, and, you know, for most of us, or all of us, we've done our time.
These are not illegal immigrants. They didn't sneak into the U.S.
American Bill Harrod was living in Cambodia when the deportees began arriving in 2002. He says back in the U.S., officials had left refugees to fend for themselves.
Because of the failure of the refugee resettlement program, no case officer came around and knocked on the door and said, you need to fill out these papers to get citizenship.
Harrod's charity, the Returnee Integration Support Center, or RISC, is staffed by deportees and helps newcomers through the difficult adjustment.
They actually live here in this building if they don't have any place else to go, or we pay to put them in a guest house and just help them get on their feet. And then, you know, we find out what their interests are, what their work experience is, and try to help them find jobs.
GED graduate Nanga.
RISC has helped 50 American deportees train for and obtain jobs teaching English, and keeps tabs on them as they assimilate into Cambodian society.
USA.
Despite many success stories, some deportees succumb to drug use, mental health problems, and crime. Harrod lost an eye when grabbing Drano out of the hands of a despondent deportee.
And some don't make it. We've had suicides. And it's heartbreaking when we realize that, you know, maybe if we'd made another field visit or another phone call or taken them out for pizza one more time, we might have been able to help them get across that blockage.
Deportees struggle with whether or not to reveal their criminal records. Hang works as an advertising manager at a local English language newspaper and was candid with his employer.
I've made a mistake in the past. I've did my time for it. I've rehabilitated. So please don't look at what I've done in the past affect what I can contribute. And they've been very good to me about it.
But Fia, who was deported for credit card fraud, needed 3 years to open up to others about her past.
I was lonely. I was depressed. I was lost.
She now teaches Cambodian children in a Phnom Penh school, but she isn't raising her own 13-year-old son, who remains in California with his father.
I'm angry that this has fractured my relationship with my son. We don't have that communication anymore. I don't know if he's gonna turn out to be angry at me or just holding grudges against me or just feel lonely that I'm not there.
He visited her last year for the first time. She hopes it won't be the last.
He didn't know how to call me mom anymore. You know, that hurts.
Well, Bobby, come on.
In the U.S., deportee families and Cambodian American community leaders have lobbied American officials for changes in immigration policy, with few results. Last year, Calvin Heng had a realization.
I just blurted it out like, you know, let's take it to the Cambodian government.
Heng recruited his deportee friends and formed a political action group, One Love Cambodia. They are pushing to amend the repatriation agreement from the Cambodian side. Most crucially, they want the Cambodian government to refuse to accept anyone who was once a refugee. To their surprise, this group of ex-convicts was granted a meeting with high-level officials at Cambodia's Interior Ministry.
They sat there and listened to each of our stories and seeing what we struggle here.
No one had gone up to them and officially filed for a grievance and, you know, really let them know that, you know, this is really, really messing up our communities and our families across the U.S.
Only days after that meeting, the Cambodian government sent a letter to the American Embassy, requesting to amend the current repatriation agreement and suspend temporarily the implementation until a new deal is struck. The U.S. rejected Cambodia's request to suspend deportations and has sometimes withheld visas and economic aid from countries that refuse to accept deportees. U.S. officials have agreed to a first discussion with Cambodia, expected to take place soon. Just 10 days ago, Cambodia's prime minister publicly demanded to renegotiate the agreement, calling the deportations a sad separation of families.
Because nobody ever stepped up to them and told them, like, this is what's happening.
The One Love Cambodia team is assisting the Cambodian government in preparation for the talks. talks they hope will yield changes that might come too late for them, but could stop others from following in their footsteps.